Brothers and sisters of Belgium, I thank you all for your sweet presence this evening. Asked, expected to speak about yoga, health and healing this evening. A very important subject of this decade, because this is a deciding period for many scientific aspects of mankind. Science has made big strides and sweeps enough to cover one century, and the speed man has created is man is not able to imagine now. So in many fields that are really scientific, there is much development, sometimes desirable and sometimes undesirable. It is inevitable because the speed is too much. But at the same time, there are certain values which do not change. For example, the health of a human being. Health is as important as it was in the previous centuries. And it is the one thing whose speed cannot be changed with the change of the speed of the space age. Man can change the speed of everything except his own mind. If at all he makes a change in the speed of his mind, if at all he accelerates the speed of his mind, it is at the cost of his health he has to do, and there is no alternative. He can make instruments which gain speed. He can travel in a supersonic speed, and he can get things done within an unbelievably short time. For example, a split second. But if for one moment he increases the speed of his mind, he has to grow crazy and he has to live under great tension and go into nervousness and live as a psychic patient. So whatever man achieves is pleasurable only when the speed of the mind is not altered, because mind is not an existence in itself. It's not an item in itself, but it is the resultant of many forces at work. Just like the foam upon a glass of beer, which does not make the beer very much. Just like the bubbles of soap floating on water, just as each bubble is not an item in itself, and just as it is a resultant of many thousands of forces at work. Similarly, the human mind is only a resultant of many thousands of forces at work, and it is not at all an item by itself. So, when we change the conditions that make the mind work, the mind begins to work differently, and we cease to be the masters of mind. We should remember that mind is only an instrument and not ourselves. Just as the body is an instrument, just as the various parts of our body are instruments, just as the senses and their functions are instruments, the mind is also an instrument and it is not ourselves. Similarly, the intellect is not ourselves, it is also an instrument. The emotional plane is also a layer of the instrument and it is not ourselves. Every layer of consciousness working around ourselves is only an instrument and not ourselves. We are different from any one of these layers of consciousness that are working around us. Just as the onion, existence of the onion is different from the existence of any one of the layers of the onion. But if we take off all the layers of onion, there is no existence of onion. The onion manifests itself through its own layers, but at the same time the onion is not any one of the layers. The onion is the unity of all the layers, which was there before the birth of the layers. just as the flower is the unity of all the petals, and no petal forms flower. When we understand ourselves in such a way, we will understand what health is. Health is the right relationship between ourselves and any one of the layers around us. If the mind has its own right relationship with us, if the senses form a part of ourselves without working independently, if the parts of the body work as our own parts, each without working independently, then we find all the layers are parts of ourselves and no layer is. Then the experience we have is what we call health. It is nothing but perfect ease and comfort. The ease that we observe in nature, the calm that we observe in nature, the unchangeable background that we observe in nature, which works as the background of the ever-changing universe, should be understood before we understand what health is. This is a century where the medical science is wrongly understood as science of health. The result is now there is a big crisis. For the past 40 or 50 years, we are required to believe that medical science is science of health. Understand that science of health has nothing to do with medical science. Only when we default with the laws of nature, then we have to pay the penalty, and then only we are called patients. Then we are sick. Then only the necessity of medicine comes. Then only comes the necessity of medical science. So, if we properly understand ourselves, medical science is not a necessity but a luxury. Because the more we want to default against the laws of nature, the more we have the necessity of medical science. I eat when I do not require. If I do not sleep when it is time to sleep. If I sleep when it is not time, then it is disease. And we have to pay the penalty. The penalty is paid in the form of suffering. And unfortunately, the suffering is understood as disease. And medicine is aimed at the suffering and not the disease. That is the unscientific nature of the present medical science. With all the our respects to the great achievements medical science have made. But now we are at a point when we think that we cannot live without medicines. There was a time when mankind lived without medicines. And afterwards, mankind discovered the science of medicine. Even then, mankind never believed that medicine was inevitable. Mankind believed that medicine was necessary only when the human beings became sick. Afterwards, medicine has become a commerce. And to produce medicine and to sell it has become a necessity. For that, doctors are being produced every year in large numbers. Because the pharmacy companies will go a loss if doctors are not increased. So the production of doctors has become a necessity. The production of doctors has become a necessity. And now the civilian, common man is made to think that he is helpless without medicine and a doctor. And the crisis has come to such a point that there are many people who do not spend the day without a medicine. And there are some more people who do not spend the day without taking many medicines. There are some people who eat more quantity of medicines than food. And if that were to be the experience of living, it is better to die than to experience such a life. When life were to be an inferno, to take more medicines than food and drink, and shut up every suffering into our constitution, then life is not worth living. The most pleasant thing that we can do is to die. But nature proves that life is worth living. The very instinct of fear of death proves that life is worth living. and proves that life is more valuable than any other values we have created. After life is given to us by nature, then only we have created the other values, our money, our banks, our houses, our property, our relationships, marriages and children. All these things are only man-made values depending upon the gift of life by nature. Unless nature permitted us to take a birth, unless we are permitted to take the first breath, we have no chance of creating any one of these values. So it is first of all foolish to think that any one of these values are more valuable than life. If anyone thinks that money is more valuable than life and gets a heart attack when his business is bad, he is a perfect fool, because he does not remember that his life is more valuable than the money he has created. So we have to remember the real values and real gifts of nature and the secondary values created by the human mind. No doubt secondary values are also valuable because human mind is valuable, but all of them depend upon our existence, and we can never think that we can depend upon any one of those values. Is there any sense in believing that our beard or hair can save us? Similarly, the things which have grown from us outside, for example, our money, our business, and our social affairs and social values, cannot save us. We have to maintain them, and they can never maintain us. Always, this is the relationship. Unless we remember this relationship, we are not evolved enough to live as healthy beings. And this is a time when there comes a real change in the medical values. We find a great inflation in medicinal values. The number of medicines are being multiplied, and the number of methods of applying medicine are multiplied, and the number of diseases that kill soon are being multiplied more than the number of medicines. There is a race between the increasing number of medicines and the increasing number of diseases. And no one can deny that the number of diseases are being multiplied more speedily than the number of medicines we are discovering. So there is something wrong with our understanding. Fundamentally, there is something wrong in understanding about health and disease. Let us try to minimize the medicines we take and see what happens. Nothing happens except some suffering. But the suffering decreases day by day, and the resistance of our constitution increases day by day. This is the only inevitable result if we begin to minimize the number of medicines. During the past 40 or 50 years, the wave of yoga has come into existence into the Occident, and many people have took to it, practiced it, and made big achievements in it. And those who have made real yoga practice for a very long time, they have inevitably reduced the number of medicines they use, and finally they stopped using medicine. And the result is that they have become more and more healthy year by year. As they have grown older in age, they have grown younger in health. You can see the standing examples in any country, and this is a statistical fact which cannot be denied by anyone. At the same time, the people who are accustomed to take more and more medicines daily are going helpless day by day. Their general health is decreasing day by day. Their resistance has gone down, and the vital force to endure anything has gone down. They live as the thermometers and the barometers to the changes of the atmosphere. Any change in the sky or through the window is recorded upon that person, and no change in the environment escapes without touching the helpless fellow. This is the unhappy experience of those who are increasing the and the people of medical science are encouraging this instead of discouraging people to take more medicines. It's most unfortunate that a scientist misleads common man, but we have it in the 20th century, and I don't think mankind has passed such a dark history in the past centuries, that a man of science deceiving a common man for the sake of his commercial motives is not seen in any century in any country in the past history. Excuse me if I am a bit harsh, but facts can never be denied. Every day the doctors are advising people to take the pills and to postpone the menstrual cycles, and they are playing with hormones without knowing anything of the hormones at all. And the knowledge of hormones is still in its infant stage to mankind, but we play with hormones without knowing the results. In fact, the present mankind is not fit to use hormones for human health. Our knowledge is too little and our experience is too scanty, and it is too foolish to use hormones. These are the facts. The necessity to maintain health has become more immediate, and basic changes in the foundations of our daily life have become imperative. However difficult it may be, if we fail to make such changes, we are bound to live as helpless beings, giving birth to children who are congenital idiots, congenital heart patients, and children who are psychosomatics because of the disturbance of the hormones during their birth. Imagine the fate of the human society after 50 years if things go in the same direction. We are already experiencing the results. When we see the international political heads precipitating the situation into a world war, we can understand how crazy and unhealthy and sickly their minds are, and how restless they are heading to a total destruction of the world. All this is nothing but the results of too much drugging. When a product of overdrugging becomes an administrative head of a country, he will work as a crank and a fool and lead the country and other countries also into destruction. And we have seen two world wars after the medical science has advanced enough. Now, I will make an open thinking about the fundamental changes we have to make. First of all, believe that medicine never cures disease. Medicine can stimulate your vital force to cure itself. That is what every system of medicine except allopathy proves. Homeopathy and Ayurveda prove the same thing. Homeopathy and Ayurveda prove the same thing. Iskadar proves the same thing. Naturopathy proves the same thing. And the ancient Arabic medicine proves the same thing. Any system of medicine in the world except allopathy strongly proves and believes that medicines will never cure diseases. Medicines are used to stimulate the vital force to cure itself. That is why in homeopathy the medicine used is very, very negligible. Same thing with other systems also. The auto-healing centers of the constitution should be allowed to cure themselves. Medicine should be used only when it is absolutely necessary. Even that only for some time until we gain the confidence that we can live without medicine. And there are some medicines to which we are addicted, many of us, and that suddenly we cannot cut them off. For example, the sleeping pills. the stress medicines, tranquilizers, and all such dirty medicines, which contain nothing but narcotics. And when once the patient stops them suddenly, he may go into a breakdown, total breakdown of health. Such people can gradually reduce the number of medicines, taking the guidance of a person who has already practiced it. After 1 year or 2 years, you will find that the person requires no medicine at all. How to stop is the problem. You might have heard an incident in the life of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, the guru of Vivekananda, a person who was addicted to this much of opium came to him one day and he asked him, "How can I get rid of this? I have seen many yogis and mahatmas, but nobody could help me. I cannot live without this. My nerves will pull away if I do not take the opium daily." Then he smiled and said, "You bring a little sensitive balance to me with which you weigh gold." In India, gold is weighed with small balances with some seeds on the other side. The fellow got it and the guru said, "You bring 1 day's dose of opium which you take. On one side of the balance, you put it. On the other side, you put a piece of chalk. Make the chalk equal in weight with the opium you take for 1 day. Then I will do you some magic." Then the patient brought all those things and got exactly the same weight of the chalk. Then the guru said, "Don't think of stopping opium. Every day, weigh the opium with this chalk and eat it. You will see within how many days you will stop it. Have a black background of wall in your kitchen. Every day, make a mark with your chalk upon the wall so that you may count the number of days." The fellow began to do it. And he was every day drawing with the chalk a mark on the wall. After it has become half, he could understand that the quantity of opium he was taking is decreasing. Then he was very much encouraged with the idea and he continued it. And he finally has drawn the last speck of chalk on the wall and came to Paramahamsa and said, "It is gone." So if we use our skill in a constructive and a positive way, there is nothing that cannot be achieved. And skill in achieving things is yoga. That is the definition, one of the definitions of yoga in the Bhagavad Gita. It is not only pranayama, not only asanas, not only dharana, dhyana, samadhi, but it is the art of using all these valuable things. How to use yama and niyama, how to use pranayama and asana, how to use dharana, dhyana and samadhi. It is the real yoga. It is not any one of these 8 steps. The 8 steps form only the practice of yoga, but the actual science of yoga and the art of yoga living includes the skill of how we use our data. You try with your own daily routine, see how you improve. You can ask me, "Don't you take medicines?" I say, "I take medicines, but on an average of once an year. Not only myself, my family, my children, my grandchildren. 40,000 families in India who follow. The maximum number of doses they take is 10 an year. It may take some time at first, but after some time we will discover that we do not need medicine. When food materials are used with the skill, they are the medicines that cure us. If we live on liquid some days, the indisposition of the stomach will disappear the next day. If we drink some hot water on some days and keep ourselves free from eating, it cures whenever there is any disposition in the digestive system. And such adjustments can very easily be made, provided you observe the timings of your eating, drinking and sleeping. In the absence of any type of guidance, as they grow up in age, they begin to know their responsibilities and begin to behave in the proper manner and find themselves most fitting in the society in which they live. At the same time, we find children who are brought up by parents very carefully and meticulously and who are entrusted to many, many expert teachers to take care night and day. And in the expert care of psychologists, when the children are placed, we find some of these children growing up as idiots and problem children, developing